It's really my privilege to be here today and present on some of this collaborative research that I've been involved in. Scott Burnett, Vera Teisler, Kenneth Tremblay, and I recently published a chapter on intentional dental modification in the Oxford Handbook of Archaeology and Anthropology of Body Modification. There you can find a broad overview of the topic and coverage that I can only provide a glimpse of in this talk. We note that teeth, like other parts of the body, have been long modified in the process of meaning-making and interpersonal communication. The durability of teeth and the archaeological record makes them a significant source of information on past human behaviors, and in the case of their intentional modification, an incredible source of information on embodied social identities. The most common forms of dental modification include shaping through filing, chipping, and incising the visible labial surfaces and occlusal contours, the coloring of teeth through dyeing, bleaching, or painting, inlaying visible surfaces with materials like metal or stone, and intentionally removing teeth through a process I will refer to as ablation in this talk. Other unintentional forms of dental modification occur through traumatic loss, pathological conditions, idiosyncratic wear, or the use of facial piercings, among many other causes. Thus, it is always important to contextualize and carefully assess intentional, unintentional, and taphonomic modifications of teeth to avoid false claims about the lives, behaviors, and identities of past peoples. As a doctoral student, I studied patterns of dental wear across Pleistocene humans, which provided a unique opportunity to study a large number of fossils from around the world. Sometimes I encountered very strange patterns of wear, such as those shown to the right of the screen. The extremely flat wear planes on the teeth of these Pleistocene foraging peoples from Central Europe evade consensus in terms of their etiology. Luckily, some cases I came across, like incisor ablation, were much more obvious to interpret. Nonetheless, intentional permanent body modification, dental or otherwise, is globally rare in deep time. The earliest probable cases are less than 50,000 years old, and we always have to ask if they are intentional or unintentional. This is a difficult task for a number of reasons. One such reason is the lack of ethnohistoric continuity with deep past cases. Likewise, a lot of cases are chronologically early and/or regional first cases. Therefore, without a lot of comparative material, there are often some doubts in diagnosing intentionality of some modifications. Furthermore, it is difficult to compare rare case studies across time and space in meaningful ways. Some definitive cases and probable cases of dental modification in the Pleistocene include dental ablation, which is the most widely documented modification in the Pleistocene and presents some of the oldest evidence of intentional body modification. Labrets, or facial piercings, have been suggested to explain the strange wear patterns shown to the right of the screen for the individuals from Central Europe, and an example from Oldupai Gorge in Tanzania that I will discuss shortly. And filing and abrasion have been related to intentional dental modification in Southwest Asia, although there is still some questions there about the etiology of those forms. Taken together, we can see that there are very few possible examples of dental modification in the Pleistocene. Ablation is the culturally motivated, intentional removal of one or more healthy teeth during life. It is among the oldest and most widespread forms of dental modification. There are many modes of tooth removal, such as pulling, prying, knocking, or even breaking the tooth off at its cervical neck. There is also extensive variation across cultures and individuals concerning which teeth are removed, when they are removed during an individual's life, and why. Some archaeological and ethnohistoric insights into the cultural significance of ablation include, but are not limited to, rites of passage, aesthetic choices, the maintenance of traditions, practices surrounding the mourning of the deceased, and therapeutic reasons, like allowing one to still receive nourishment when facing lockjaw from tetanus. Regardless of reasons, ablation creates irreversible changes to one's appearance and even their speech, and it is generally agreed upon that it is an embodied marker of individual or group-level social identity and lived experience. Among the most well-studied examples of incisor ablation come from Iberomaurusian contexts in Northwest Africa and Natufian contexts in Southwest Asia. the earliest case of ablation in Northwest Africa is approximately 16,000 years old, but ablation only becomes ubiquitous among Iberomaurusian foraging peoples around 15,000 years ago. Ablation in these contexts most commonly targets both maxillary incisors. In contrast to the ubiquity of ablation in Northwest Africa, far fewer Natufian individuals from Southwest Asia are affected by ablation. Approximately 17% of individuals studied from sites in Southwest Asia have incisor ablation, and this focuses on the removal of only one maxillary incisor when it's commonly found. We suspect that Ohalo II, a roughly 22,500-year-old individual from Southwest Asia, also exhibits ablation. This is an interesting chronological outlier with respect to ablation practices in Northwest Africa and Southwest Asia, as it is approximately 6,000 to 8,000 years older than the earliest cases from either region. The archaeological site of Ohalo II exhibits extraordinary preservation of archaeological and human remains. The 35-to-40-year-old male burial is one of the most complete skeletons from the earlier epipaleolithic of Southwest Asia. Ohalo II suffered a major injury to the lower thorax that resulted in a large ossification of portions of the sternum, ribs, and corresponding costal cartilages. The injury would have made Ohalo II partially reliant upon social care from others, as the injury would have made prolonged physical exertion very difficult. A much less remarked upon, but fascinating to me, pathology is the loss of the upper right central incisor that was rarely remarked upon in the literature. Ohalo II has a fully healed alveolus where the right maxillary incisor should be. Given my past experience studying North African, Iberomaurusian, and the Southwest Asian Natufian material, I was strongly convinced that this could be a case of intentional incisor ablation. My colleague Sarah Lacey and I decided to explore the issue more closely. The alveolus for the missing right upper incisor is fully healed, which indicates it was lost well before the individual died. However, there is no interproximal wear facet on the left upper incisor, which would have started to form soon after the tooth was fully erupted, around the time Ohalo II was a child, about 7.5 years old. The lack of wear on this facet indicates that the tooth was probably lost in late childhood or early adolescence. There's also a lack of major oral pathological conditions, suggesting that this incisor was lost not due to any sort of other pathological condition. Furthermore, there's very little anterior dental wear contrary to previous analyses, which means that there is not enough progressive dental wear in the anterior teeth to contribute to tooth loss. The uneven mandibular occlusal wear also means that considerable time passed after the tooth was lost because the teeth continued to wear despite having the missing antagonist, and it creates this kind of scalloped look. In summary, all of these lines of evidence point towards the loss of this incisor, probably occurring early in life. There are broad similarities between Ohalo II's tooth loss and later epipaleolithic Natufian ablation practices. The most common Natufian ablation pattern is the removal of the right upper central incisor, which is exactly what we see for Ohalo II. Furthermore, the timing of the tooth loss, probably in early life, is also consistent with ritualized ablation around puberty or adolescence, and there is evidence for ablation in adolescence during the Natufian. Thus, Ohalo II is probably the first pre-Natufian epipaleolithic case of ablation from Southwest Asia. To conclude this case study, I want to discuss why it is that Ohalo II was never recognized as having ablation, while there was recognition of Natufian ablation for nearly a century. The primary reason is probably the sparse fossil record. Historically, Ohalo II has been looked at within the context of general Pleistocene human morphological variation and paleobiology in general. However, Natufians are sometimes seen as outliers when it comes to late Pleistocene foraging behavior because they're relatively sedentary and they're often thought of as being very important for understanding the transition to food production in the Neolithic. I argue that this means we look from Natufian to Neolithic, but rarely compare earlier and later Epipaleolithic humans. Historically, dental modification has also been something that is more of a bioarchaeological concern than a paleoanthropological one as well. There is recent research showing archaeological and paleobiological evidence for long-term behavioral trends in Southwest Asia. We suggest that Ohalo II's incisor ablation provides an intriguing additional source of information on possible behavioral continuities between earlier and later Epipaleolithic peoples. However, with so few earlier Epipaleolithic fossils, it remains difficult to say whether ablation is underrepresented in earlier periods, if Ohalo II is simply an anomaly, if ablation was an independent invention in the earlier Epipaleolithic, or if it represents behavioral continuity with the late Epipaleolithic. Obviously, future research will be needed to shed light on some of these questions. And with that, I want to shift to a brief discussion of intentional body modification that can create unintentional dental modifications. Facial piercings and adornments worn around the oral cavity are frequently referred to as labrets. As you can see in the examples provided here, there are numerous ways in which these adornments can be worn, and the size and shape of labrets can vary widely. Labrets may begin as very small piercings with very small labrets, but can be stretched over time to accommodate larger adornments. Archaeologically, labrets often leave a negative imprint of their presence in the form of unintentional dental wear. As we review in our book chapter in the Oxford Handbook, multiple lines of evidence are essential when addressing labret use in archaeological contexts. Your best case scenario is finding a labret in a burial, and ideally the labret is near the mouth of the individual and associated with their teeth. However, there are multiple reasons why you may not find a labret. For instance, they can be made of perishable materials like wood or leather, or they could be excluded from burials altogether. Many labrets have very distinct shapes and sizes that are easily identifiable, while some can be easily confused with other forms of adornments, such as earrings or ear spools. Atypical dental wear is a useful characteristic of labrets and typically manifests on non-occlusal surfaces of teeth. This is demonstrated by the dentin exposure shown in the drawings. Atypical wear will often form planes across neighboring teeth that are a negative imprint of the flange of the labret, the part of the labret that holds it in place. Alveolar bone remodeling, pathology such as tooth loss, and tooth movement can also be caused by labrets, but must be substantiated with other lines of evidence. Likewise, ruling out other forms of dental wear as possible causes of atypical wear is crucial. The bottom line is to use as many lines of evidence as you can. This brings us to the unusual case of Oldupai Hominid 1 from Tanzania. A little background on this fossil is that a previous direct date was deemed unreliable by a number of researchers. Unfortunately, recent efforts to directly date the fossil were unsuccessful. We performed morphological analyses to assess affinity of OH1, and we found that it is firmly within the variation of late Pleistocene and early Holocene fossils from Africa, but it is outside recent human variation. Furthermore, new dates from sedimentary quarries suggest that the age of Oldupai Hominid 1 could be around 12,000, give or take 3,400 years ago. Now, this is very consistent with a late Pleistocene or early Holocene date for this individual. So that brings us to the atypical dental wear. The wear on the mandibular incisors of OH1 was previously attributed to intentional dental filing in one instance, but this doesn't make a lot of sense as the upper incisors of this individual have no similar dental filing, and upper incisors are generally the target of this type of intentional modification. And this type of modification, filing, rarely occurs on the mandibular teeth. So it's difficult to use to suggest that this is what is going on with OH1. Alternatively, Parsh suggested that fiber processing was the cause of the unique pattern of dental wear on the mandibular teeth. However, this is also quite unlikely, given that fiber processing generally involves the occlusal, the lingual, or the interproximal surfaces in an outward pulling motion that is really inconsistent with the form of wear on the labial surfaces of these lower teeth. Therefore, we decided to look into other possibilities for this anomalous wear pattern. We performed a variety of macroscopic and microscopic analyses on the OH1 dentition and show that the wear was not consistent with other forms of intentional filing or pathological or scenarios in which the teeth were used as tools or as a third hand for manipulative behaviors. Likewise, we ruled out erosion as a possible cause for this dental wear. Instead, what we found was that the dental wear was very consistent with the negative imprint left by wearing an adornment or a labrette through the lower lip. We also went further and tried to find a baseline for the dental wear using the posterior teeth as well. And we were quite amazed, actually, when looking at the buccal surfaces to see that there were large wear facets on many of the premolars and molars on both the maxillary and mandibular teeth. Here you can see them as the very flat wear planes indicated by the yellow dotted line. These are very similar to what we see in ethnohistoric and bioarchaeological contexts in which labrette wear, a labrette is worn through piercings in the cheeks near the corners of the mouth. Thus, we ultimately suggested that OH1 wore both cheek and lower lip labrettes. Regardless of the patterning of it, this would be the first documentation of probable labrette use outside of the Nile Valley in the late Pleistocene or early Holocene of Africa. To conclude, I want to acknowledge the work of Christopher Stojanowski and colleagues that have identified spatial and temporal patterning of incisor ablation across Africa in the Pleistocene and Holocene. While I won't repeat all of their work here, I do want to note that labrette use and other forms of dental modification can be added to these reviews. Here you can see labrette use indicated by the orange open circles across the three maps, showing its variation in space and time. I also note the presence of incisor ablation and its absence in Southwest Asia during the Pleistocene. To conclude, we suggest that there is a deeper antiquity for incisor ablation in Southwest Asia than previously shown, and suggest it is another possible long-term trend linking the earlier and later Epipaleolithic. Our labrette work at Olduvai Gorge also suggests that late Pleistocene body modification practices were more diverse than previously acknowledged in Pleistocene Africa. Furthermore, labrette wear can provide another line of evidence for exploring the temporal and spatial dimensions of body modification and embodied identities in the deep past. And with that, many thanks to our organizers, all of those individuals at CARTA that have helped put on the symposium, the curators of the museums, my funders, and all of my collaborators, of course, and you for watching the presentation. And thank you.